Christiane, what more did you learn about not only the regime within Iran in itself, but also obviously what is worrying everyone else, and that's their nuclear capability?
First, on the Syria issue, I asked Mr. Larijani about that because there is evidence and reports that Iranians are advising the regime of Bashar Assad. And Mr. Larijani said to me that they do not want any outside interference, and so that's why they are involved there. They do not want the U.S. to be involved there. They think that that would just make the situation worse. Obviously, this is still a bone of contention in the international community, why Iran is supporting the government of Bashar Assad. We also obviously talked about the massive crisis that is on the international stage right now concerning Iran's nuclear program. And here, Mr. Larijani, who is a close advisor to Iran's supreme leader, Ayatollah Khamenei, told me about how they saw these new negotiations, date still uncertain, but how they should go. He was very insistent that despite this crisis, Iran was not going to give up on its, what he called, legitimate nuclear aspirations under international obligations and laws, that Iran would not give up its enrichment for civilian and peaceful purposes, but he said that they must diffuse this current, what he called, dispute, and he put forth a series of two steps, in other words, to create confidence that Iran would give transparency as the world demands, but in return ask for cooperation from the United States and from the Western powers. I did also ask him about the Parchin military facility near Tehran, which the IAEA wants to visit because it believes that somewhere in the early part of this decade, nuclear-related explosive experiments may have taken place. This was Mr. Larijani's answer.
Well, first of all, this Parchin issue is a recurrent issue. Once it has been discussed, and a lot of evidence was given to the agency, but still, with the new request, Iran did not reject that. Iran asked elucidation on what basis, what kind of tests they want to do, when they want to look, and what will be the end result. As I said, it is a two parallel line. If the Western community is asking us for more transparency, then we should expect for more cooperation.
Is anything nuclear related happening, or did it happen at Parchin?
Not at all. I think they know pretty well. I think United States intelligence services and the Western, they know that we are not after building nuclear weapons. This is part of a game about us. The Western community can ask only from us transparency under NPT. We also obliged. We have to give them the transparency, but it is also our honest-to-God right to ask for cooperation in other parts of NPT. Let's make a parallel.
Iran's supreme leader the other day again mentioned his fatwa against nuclear weapons. He called it again publicly a great sin. What message is he sending? Is he sending a message to President Obama that Iran will not cross Obama's red lines, will not go military in its nuclear program?
Iran is a serious player in the region. Iran is not after nuclear weapon. The message is clear. Deal with Iran as it is. Iran is not after nuclear weapon. Nuclear weapon is not an asset for us. It's more liability. Pakistan has nuclear weapon. You see, it's a shamble country in terms of security. It doesn't add to our security. We are secure enough. We are strong enough without nuclear weapon. And it is against the fatwa of Ayatollah Khamenei. Nobody has daring to do that.
So even if Iran was attacked, you wouldn't decide to go towards a nuclear military program?
This is the fatwa of Imam Khomeini and the fatwa of Ayatollah Khamenei. So if somebody thinks in the world that by attacking Bushehr or other places in Natanz,
Or Fordo,
then Iran will be deprived or delayed for 10, 20 years in their progress in the development of nuclear technology, they are deadly wrong.
Is there an opportunity for some kind of, I don't want to use grand bargain, but some kind of big negotiation to normalize relationships between Iran and the United States?
I'm one of those most outspoken person during the past three decades favoring dialogue with the United States. Even with your fiercest enemy, you should have a line of dialogue and sit down and talk.
So I guess the question is all this worth it? The billions of dollars that you've spent, the years under sanctions, the crisis that could be coming to a head, is it all worth it?
Oh, yes.
Because it actually hasn't enriched you.
No, very much enriched us. We are not secondary citizens of the world. We are number one citizen of the world. We want to enjoy exactly the same rights the United States and United States people enjoying at the international level. Don't tell us that you are a little bit below. This is almost impossible that any Iranian can buy it. So if the United States has the right to enrich uranium, to build this power plant, we have the right as well. We want to build power plant ourselves, the next one, and we can do it. So treat us as a first-degree citizen. Then we will be more forthcoming.
Mr. Lorigiani, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
And so you could see from the way he was speaking and what he was suggesting that they want to have a relationship that obviously builds confidence. He said there's no confidence between Iran and the West and vice versa. The lack of confidence is a two-way street. It can't, as he said, be bought in a grocery store. It has to be acquired. And again, Iran's bargaining position apparently coming into the new negotiations will be a two-way street, he says. Parallel lines, we give you some transparency, you give us cooperation. Remains to be seen whether the West will buy that or whether it will want everything out front from Iran. Iran is saying that that is sort of a non-starter. But certainly Mr. Lorigiani putting a best face forward on negotiations, saying that they must succeed. This is a really, you know, important moment. I asked him about war. Were they prepared for war? And he said, we are prepared to defend ourselves. This has also been a great issue of speculation around the world. What would Iran do?
Yeah.
And he would not say exactly. He just said, just as Mr. Obama said, all options are on the table. We say the same. All options are on the table. We can defend ourselves. And he also denied that Iran's policy was aggression towards Israel. You know, a huge amount of concern has come out of Israel regarding what President Ahmadinejad said a few years ago about wiping Israel off the map. He said that's not what the president meant, and it's not Iran's official policy.
And Israel has been using that as their increasing rhetoric against Iran's nuclear capability. And is there a sense then, I guess a lot of people still want to know, how capable is Iran of a nuclear threat?
Well, Iran,
how much of a threat,
Iran is denying, as you've seen, that it has any nuclear ambitions. And of course, U.S. and other intelligence agencies, including the Israeli intelligence agency, do not believe that Iran has made any decision to take its program into a military capacity. Mm. What the Israelis and the U.S. and the Western, where they differ, is the timelines. Israel feels that it has less time to less time to confront a program than the Americans do. The Americans believe that there is time and space for diplomacy, and that's what President Obama is trying to pursue, and that's what Iran says that it wants to engage in as well right now.